Support for Character Crusade comes from audiobooks.com. Audiobooks make it possible to enjoy a story, learn something new, or find inspiration anytime, anywhere, and with more than 60,000 titles available, audiobooks.com makes it easy and convenient. Simply set up your account and start downloading your favorite books to your mobile device. Right now, you can start with a free 30-day trial and select the book of your choice to get started. Go to book.charactercrusade.com and start listening today.
Greetings, Crusaders. You're listening to Character Crusade Skyrim Roleplay Workshop. I'm Joe.
I'm Matt.
And I'm Stu. And tonight, we're talking about overpowered mods. Specifically, OP equals BS.
And in episode number 13, by
yes,
the way.
Yes, we made it to episode number 13.
Can you believe it?
Yeah, this is our lucky episode, clearly.
Totally.
Yeah, if you haven't had a chance to listen to episode 12 yet, we encourage you to go back and do that. It was so much fun having Jessa on the show.
Absolutely.
Yes, and the good news is we are going to be having her back on a recurring basis to do mod roundtables with us.
Yes.
So you can look forward to that, you know, a few times a year, hopefully. We'll get her here every 2 or 3 months, and we'll kind of do another roundtable session. That was super fun.
She put up with us for like 2.5 hours.
I know. It was kind of amazing, actually, that anyone would do that. You know, we've actually had quite a few people
like
now
on
who
purpose,
put up with
other
us.
Than us.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm used to you guys now, but you know that you know how it is. You get used to your own stink after a while.
I was going
to
say, you do sort of get used to your own smell. It's like camping for a week. Ooh, what is that? It's a film. It's a film of...
It's a protective layer.
Yeah. God, the woods smell funny here. What is that? You know, why do the woods smell different here?
It smells kind of like the gym.
Yeah. What's with that? So, yeah.
And spam.
Tonight... In our play theory segment, we're going to talk a little bit about this concept of overpowered or game-breaking mods, and more specifically, how you can tailor your game difficulty to the kind of game that you want to play. But first, we're going to go through our character craft segment. We're pretty excited about that. It's been a while since we've been able to do that. Before I get to that, we're going to level up. Let's level up, Matt.
Thanks, Stu. Hey, we got a lot of people listening, and it's great. It's even better when we can hear from some folks who have got some interesting reasons for giving. And we've just got a new Patreon supporter. And for those who have been wondering what's an appropriate level to give, it really is anything. If you think that you got to give the $100 a month level, we're not going to turn that away, right?
No, never.
But like many of us started in other areas, Patreon starts at $1 if you want to do it that way. And it's so great because it just shows a little bit of support and it makes a big difference for us. And we really appreciate everyone who gives it. So when you start off with $1 a month, like we're hearing our latest supporter, we'll call him E, whatever we want to do.
His name is Ernie.
Ernie, thanks, Ernie. And then Ernie decided to go and triple his amount every month, up to $3 a month. Now, some people may say that that isn't going to make a difference. In my heart, I know that it makes a difference. Someone's making a commitment to us. We are making a commitment to you, Ernie. We're going to use that money wisely, and we're going to turn it into another fantastic series of shows here. From the bottom of our heart, thank you very much.
Yes. Thank you so much, Ernie, for, you know, a three septum a month continuing donation. We will put every one of those septums to great use.
To great use.
Yes.
Thanks, Ernie. So,
thank you very much.
Cool. Thank you.
That's the only one that we've got this month. Not because people aren't listening, but because maybe people are shy. Don't be shy.
Yeah. Don't be shy.
Just run out into the tundra and yell that it's time it's time to support the crusade.
Well, honestly, it does make a big difference. So at this point, we're fortunate enough to have, seven people who've decided to support us, coming to a total of $30 a month. And that is taking care of hosting for us. Mm-hmm. It's putting a big dent in, the fees that we have to pay to keep the website up, things like that. So every bit makes a difference. So we definitely
You didn't like buy a new Ferrari yet or anything, did you?
No, and that will never happen,
because
sir.
It's all going into... Yes. The production. Now, the merchandising, that's different.
Oh,
right?
Totally different.
The bobblehead that we're getting
totally
of you?
Different.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, yeah. But, well...
A stew bobblehead. I want one of those.
A stew bobblehead. Okay. Yeah, we could do that.
Vinyl top?
Yeah. with the Nord helmet.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. No, yeah. Yes. No.
I love that. I love it. Yeah.
With one of our custom t-shirts printed on the front.
One of the naked Nord t-shirts.
Yes, absolutely.
That we're
going to
roll out.
Yeah.
No.
At some point.
Hey, it takes time to perfect the design.
Talk about the merchandise. I still have yet to see it. Come on.
Well, the
it's like the Emperor's new clothes.
What are you keeping
I have one
from
on
me?
Right now.
The naked Nord t-shirt design is up on the website.
Oh.
It's on the about page, specifically under Matt's character section. You can see the naked Nord logo. In fact, I'm going to look at it right now.
Where is it?
It's fantastic.
About
the Naked Nord Society.
Yes.
Oh, and what's the tagline?
Boot and about halfway down.
Yeah. The Naked Nord Society, running our members up and down the throat of the world.
All
what?
7,000 steps.
Why are you looking at me funny? Is it something I said?
No.
Okay. Well, yeah.
It'd work on bumper stickers, too.
Yeah, I think it's quite attractive. And I actually made it in vector.
It's sort of scalable.
You know,
so this is like the best version of a silhouetted thing ever. Mm-hmm. It's way better than Snapchat. You totally want that thing on a billboard.
For sure.
We don't have the trademark thing on there.
I think
though,
we'll need a few more patrons for a billboard, but
you know what though? If we can start a Skyrim sort of instant chat session and call it the Naked Nord, and we can have bazillions of people download our app. That would be great. Until then, I think that we're just going to maybe keep meeting here.
Give relationship advice, or what is the Naked
but
Nord?
It's only relationship advice so far as Skyrim goes. So it might not be immediately applicable to people's lives
well,
now. But
that's true.
Only
that's
in true. Skyrim. It's still important. It's like 15 million people playing Skyrim. They need relationship advice.
Hmm. You know, I guess in this day and age, some people still do bring melee weapons to dates, but not as many as probably used to.
Or maybe some cases ought to.
Yeah, right. Depends on the neighborhood, right?
It's just showing up with the loot just sort of sets the wrong tone, if you'll excuse
the loot
pun.
Or the loot?
L-U-T-E. Oh. You can bring as much loot as you want.
Okay.
Right. Well, you know what? Let's get to character craft, shall we?
Yes.
Enough of this inane drivel.
Tangent.
On to character craft. Stick around. Welcome to Character Craft. Tonight we're actually going to go around and talk about each of the characters we are currently playing. It has been some time with all the interviews since we've been able to do this. So we'll have a little bit of catching up to do here, but we're going to take about 10 minutes or so and start with your character, Joe. What do you got?
All right. Well, I have to think back a little bit. Ienarath, I'm still playing her. Mm-hmm. And currently she's up around 33rd level, almost. 32nd.
Wow, getting there.
Yeah, yeah.
Seriously.
So, yeah, it's power weekends.
I'm just in awe. Uh-huh.
Start at about 9 in the morning and go to bed around 1 in the morning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I mean, what Joe is doing, though, I mean, he's, you know, doing quests and stuff like that. That's legit levels there, too.
So. I have been lately, yeah. What was the list?
I'll cut that.
Yeah, thank you.
I think you should leave it.
It could be your signature thing, man.
That's not a good signature. So she is still going or hanging around in Blackreach. I've actually explored a lot more of Blackreach with her. As she's gone up levels, I've felt a little bit better about surviving the rest of Blackreach.
So, how much of it have you covered, do you think?
Oh, gosh. I bet I've probably got about 80 to 90% of it at least. I went and took out the wisp, the mother wisp down there. She's kind of a chore, so I wanted to get her out of the way.
And, mother wisp.
Yeah, they're kind of tough. And then I found a couple of the other lifts. I would pronounce them, but I don't exactly know how. So,
yeah.
Mazanchalef and Rothbard, whatever the hell they're called.
The Schlachtenforken? Yeah. That lift that you can pronounce once and never again.
You know, and even the easy one I've been screwing up. It's you know, it's not Aftland, it's Alftand.
A Flutnerfergen. Yeah, it's like
freaking Dwemer.
Trying to write it in your journal and it never appears the same way twice. Is there a Z and an M and an L and an F and a T and a... It's all consonants?
It's all consonants. That's how is
pretty
this possible?
Yes.
So,
good thing we're not ready.
I've explored enough of that to find pretty much, I think, all the lifts that I can that go up to the surface.
Okay.
I found a couple that go to other parts that lead to Blackreach, but because of how I started with the alternate starts, they are all currently blocked off because I haven't started the quest to actually enter Blackreach yet.
Isn't that weird?
Yeah, I've been spending all my time down there, and I'm not supposed to be there.
So you can open up those pathways, but you have to kind of go to the surface and then do a quest and come back down again through...
Yeah, whatever. And honestly, at this point, it's been so long since I've actually done anything in Blackreach via the way that was intended.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I even remember what those quests were.
Hmm.
So yeah. If I wanted to dive into Blackreach, how do you get there?
That's what I can't remember.
Okay.
There's a couple of different ways. You know, one of the things that always comes to mind for me is just going to visit, what is his name? Septimus? Cygnus? The crazy old man. He lives in an ice cave way up in the frozen north.
Right.
And you take his quest and he'll definitely send you down there. Is also...
I haven't gone up to visit him yet.
Part of the Dark Brotherhood quest line.
Okay, and I haven't kicked that one off yet either.
Yeah,
so.
But.
There's definitely a couple different ways to start the quest that will get you into Blackreach, but because I started there...
You didn't have to worry about getting there.
I didn't have to get there. Yeah. So, but alternate start the author did think ahead and has blocked off all ways of navigating those quest lines backwards.
Oh, really?
So, I mean, I can go through the doors that I would normally come into, but they're all walled off.
Yeah.
I can't go any further.
And that makes sense.
That's cool.
It does. Otherwise, because inadvertently, there's no doubt I would probably break something on the quest.
Yeah, that'd be way overpowered.
Totally.
If you could do that. It'd
can
just
you
be,
imagine? Like,
it'd be
so
like,
totally wrong, dude.
Game breaking and overpowered.
I'll tell you, starting out at level one in Blackreach isn't overpowered.
No way. You got screwed, man.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
Run away. Oh, my God.
There's
it was horrible.
So many ways to die down there.
Seriously, when you're fighting with a herring, is just you mm-hmm. can't win.
No.
You can't.
A herring.
Slap you.
That's bad.
You my fish.
So you've explored Blackreach pretty thoroughly at this point.
I've explored Blackreach pretty thoroughly, yes.
You find all the Crimson Nurn root yet?
I've found a bunch, and I know they've respawned.
Really?
I actually have, Some of them have respawned because I've been down there long enough.
I guess I never considered the fact that maybe they would respawn.
Mm-hmm.
Like
so
ever.
I don't know how many I have, but I've got 30 plus.
130.
I'll have to go. Well, there's a little satchel in Sindarin's field lab mm-hmm. that I've been, every time I get down there, I stuff all my ingredients into it.
Okay.
So
it's not such a little satchel anymore.
No, it's jam-packed.
It's a Duluth pack.
It's a Duluth pack.
Yeah.
It is.
It'll fit everything.
That's right.
But I've been building up my outpost down there a lot.
I see a role play opportunity here to be the, okay, this isn't fair though. This is your character. This isn't Robbard.
This is a suggestion.
He would take advantage of this Crimson Nurnroot thing and kind of corner the market somehow. I think it's pretty cool.
I wish you could do co-op, right? Because he's collecting your, making and distributing.
Yeah, if I could sell it, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. We'll sign it. We'll sign a contract. I'll have my people call your people.
Sounds good.
I wonder if I made skooma with a twist of Crimson Nurnroot during the brewing process, what would happen?
That's a good question.
Infused with the flavor
of Crimson Nurnroot.
If you can infuse gin with cucumber, you can infuse skooma with
Crimson
Nurnroot.
Absolutely.
For sure.
It would be to die for.
Yes. It would. Probably, literally.
I would kill
anyone
you
wants
to have that.
We'll see this mod on Nexus pretty soon, too.
Yeah.
The other thing
it'll just be Crimson Skooma.
I did complete the Namira quest.
Okay.
As I've started out with Ienarath, she is a dark character, so mm-hmm. she has embraced Markarth and all its darkness. And so I did follow that one through. She embraced the cannibalistic.
Yep.
Air. So. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you never go hungry again, basically.
I never go hungry again.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
What? What? I'm just.
It's always a lot
saying.
Of options.
Oh,
too.
My word.
Yes.
I was going to. There's. You know? It's just not the thing that you normally hear.
I know,
never,
right?
Never go hungry.
You know, it's
I'm sorry. I can't control myself.
So she, so
step
she,
aside
so,
for a minute.
So
awesome.
She's. Well, I don't know if I would say she's embraced it, but she's definitely had a curiosity and fulfilled her curiosity.
Whether or not
she would continue down that.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I haven't decided. We'll see how it plays out. I've also let her turn into a vampire.
Oh.
So she may let, they kind of go hand in hand, really.
They really do, actually.
So
food and beverage.
There you go.
Go together like something.
So
and
something,
something
to wash that down with.
Yeah.
What's wrong, Matt?
I'm laughing so hard, no sound is coming out. See, nice. You learn so much when you talk with others about mm-hmm. their characters because mine's just trying to find arrows and stuff. So,
she's decided to embrace. Well, she caught the vampirous virus mm-hmm. condition, disease, whatever mm-hmm. it is. Disease, I think, technically.
Yep.
And once, and I cured that because she didn't feel it was the right time. And then she caught it again on another vampire encounter she had. So she kind of took that as, I'm going to go with it. And we're going to call it, this is a tool.
That was our timer, ladies and gentlemen.
I guess my time is up.
We got a 10-minute timer here, but we started a little bit late, so we're going to continue.
I'll see if I can continue. Kind of get through this a little quick.
Unrestrained.
So.
Just.
All right. So Vampire, she decided to embrace that and considers it a tool that she can use for Mehrunes mm-hmm. Dagon right. on his behalf or her behalf. I guess mm-hmm. there's no real gender. So she has done that. And in the Namira quest, to kind of backtrack just a bit, she ended up taking Eola as a follower.
Mm-hmm.
So the two of them kind of hooked up
okay.
In more ways than one, but that's another day.
Sweet. She's kind of a spell sword, I believe.
Yeah, yeah. And right? I had to actually release her from being a follower. I took her along with me on my journeys, and she kept getting into fights with my conjurations and my summons. And
oh, really?
anytime she just yeah. brushes past something that might be considered friendly fire, she just goes berserk.
Yeah.
And she starts casting stuff. And
she's so confrontational.
Oh, my God. I'm like,
so uncomfortable.
You're in the way. Yeah, so what I brought her down to Blackreach, mm-hmm. and I dismissed her there.
What did she okay. do?
So I just let her hang out in Blackreach in my outpost.
Oh, okay.
I'll
so she hang.
Here.
You
so
didn't
she
was, dismiss her. You
no.
hang, she's hanging out. Still
yeah,
though.
She was hanging okay. out in Blackreach, and I came down there, and as often okay. as I do, I come upon my outpost is just getting attacked by something every
yeah.
time because I'm gone long enough. When I come yeah. back, all of a sudden I got werewolves or Falmer or all sorts of crap attacking me.
Yeah.
I've had 3 dragon attacks down there now.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah, so I don't know where these things are getting in from, but...
They hate you like bad.
Oh, man. So
you got like some yeah. dragon paper up somewhere?
they stick on <them. laughs>
Big dragon strip.
Okay.
Oh,
they
got
it.
That would be
there's
got
to be a spell for that now. That'd be overpowered.
That would be overpowered.
Modding community
so
unite.
Yes. Like fly paper, except
dragon
for dragons.
Paper.
Very big.
Just wrap it around any yes. kind of watchtower, you're all set.
Oh, my God. God. My problem there, though, was the same thing because I hired a lot of mages to help keep an eye out over my watch. And Eola is really strong.
Mm-hmm.
So she kept wiping out all my guards because she'd get hit by friendly fire and she'd go berserk and just go around murder everyone.
She is a beast.
I'm like, holy crap.
I like
you've
her,
got to just... So I actually just dismissed her completely and she left Blackreach.
This is why I have to see some of your gameplay.
This is just
fantastic.
Yeah.
You got to get out of here. Uh-huh. You're costing me money.
Stop murdering all my guards.
Well, those
it's a problem.
In
yeah.
We're
Tundra running out.
Defense, those uh-huh. those wizards are like yeah. $1,500 a pop.
Uh-huh.
Like that.
Yeah.
I can't.
You
got to
talk to the Skooma
that.
King over here and see
oh,
what
yeah.
you can do about
yeah.
setting up a distribution network.
Yeah.
So that's kind of a real big overview of some of the high points I've hit. But so yeah, expanding my outpost and completing some of the quests in Markarth.
Yeah.
And I was disappointed. Who is that Gorza or what's her name? The do you remember what her name is? The Smith in Markarth.
Oh, I don't remember her name,
yeah.
but the Orcish Smith.
Yeah. I was kind of disappointed. Early on, this was a while back, but I came in and there must have been a vampire attack on the other side of the city. And
all
I know is flashed across the screen that one of my quests failed to bring her a book.
Oh,
she
yeah.
got killed.
Oops.
Wow.
So now I got to deal with that putz there.
Vampires are brutal in that game. They will wipe out like essential, important.
Important. Not essential.
Important. Especially like the smiths and merchants and stuff, mm-hmm. man, when they get wiped out. And it's sort of
you've
depressing
had that happen
too,
with her name in Whiterun. Adriana,
yeah.
is that her name?
Yeah. And so, it's kind of sad because you go in there and the guy's running the place by himself. his wife is just
poor
dead,
widow, widower.
And more than likely the body is still laying in the street outside and nobody's taking care of that.
So just because they don't have one of those overpowered mods to help take care of your corpses.
That's true. That's way overpowered.
Or protect them before they become corpses.
Right.
Yeah.
That is kind of helpful, I've heard.
Yeah.
So
everybody's essential.
Dead people are smelly.
That's it in a fairly big nutshell.
Very good. Now we move on to Matt. What's going on, Matt?
I'm sort of on walkabout, actually.
Okay.
Interestingly, I did some stupid thing, and I was recording at home, so I don't have it here, but I stole some little rinky-dink thing, and it was like 5 gold to get out of it. And I'm like, forget it. It's not worth arguing with you about this. Okay, well, I'll take it. So they took me across the map, like,
oh, I had that happen
or something, and so now I'm way over on the, and I'm like, where the heck? I had no idea where I was.
We'll just confiscate all your stolen goods.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, thanks.
Come with us. Cross the continent.
We're going to take everything.
I know.
So then I went down, and I'm looking at it now, this Witch Mist Grove. Do you remember all this? Well, that crazy old hag killed me a few times.
Oh, yeah.
Over here. Here, let me show you, Joe. Check this out.
That's...
Because there's the Steamcrag camp where there is those couple of thieves or whatever they are over there. It was great fun because the first time through, they got really upset and they slaughtered me.
Okay.
And so when I came back, I realized that maybe I shouldn't just shoot at them first. And I still have, you know, my house Carl following around, which is fantastic.
Who do you have with you?
Lydia?
Is it Lydia?
Yeah, okay. Lydia's still with me. Lydia has been killed hundreds of times.
Really? Wow, that's actually kind of a... That's an achievement.
She doesn't have a good leader. Because I keep going, oh, look, I wonder what that is. Oh, it's a frost troll. I'm going to die. So then I send her in, and I try to find some other... By the time I get up to her, she's, you know, weeping and rocking back and forth on the ground.
That's
and
the worst.
Then gets stomped on. But anyway, so I'm in this can, and it's great. And then... This dragon flies overhead, right? Bone-strewn crest area, whatever it is. And I didn't have to do anything. Like, I was so far behind everybody that by the time I got there, the dragon had been slain, and I was too late to collect any dragon souls. And so,
what, really?
I was, yeah.
How can you be, wow.
I
so when you
have
walked up
answer.
To the dragon, no
nothing happened.
That's
really?
That's glitching then.
Yeah. If the dragon's around, if the body's there, you should be able to.
Then maybe it
some.
Is. So glitching. I'll go back.
Never heard of the soul going
many.
Stale.
No, but then there was still the place near there, nearby, where you can pick up the part of the dragon shout. Right. That was
fine. the word wall.
Yeah. But I didn't. That wasn't word.
I had a similar situation though when I was recording Aranis Arcana, where Fleet could not absorb dragon souls for a period of time, and I struggled and struggled to try and figure out what the fix was to that glitch. It's been a long time now, so I can't remember what it ended up being. But
it seems to me like that could be kind of a big obstacle.
Well, if you want to be the Dragonborn, it sure is. Yeah, that's for sure. Yeah.
Well, contrary to Joe's level 612
or 32, whichever.
I'm finally at a level 10. Right. I will admit that there were plenty of opportunities with Einar Stigander that I didn't go level up when I could. Now, whenever I have a chance to level up, I'll go try to find something really pretty quickly. But I've leveled up so many times in archery and one-handed weapons and stuff.
Oh, right.
Yeah. You know, that's kind of, so anyway.
Awesome.
At Mixwater Mill at last check now, my Khajiit is lurking around in dark shade for the first time. I have completed like 0 good quest lines, and so I'm trying. Okay. I'm trying to wrap my head around this little ADD, you know, walkabout issue, which is just trying to get everything visible on the map at the moment. Because you said in the last couple of episodes, have you gone here? No, I haven't. Well, you can't get there, and I'm certainly not fast traveling at this point because there's no place to go. You know, when you only have like 11 places, so I'm trying to just sort of meander everywhere. And back out to the map every once in a while. And at least I've got enough stuff that if I, you know, have to deal with dumping things, now I know how to do that. And
what kind of a how would you classify the character as far as, you know, combat style, that kind of thing?
Very typical for how I like to play other games. And I don't understand the value of the magic and the potions unless I'm seriously down on health or stamina.
So it's melee, two-handed, single?
Typically bow and arrow unless I get into a single-handed weapon because I've got the early on.
Archer, ranger kind of thing. Okay.
It's a very typical sniper character for those of you who have played with me in other games, right? And what I like about it is that it's nice because you can get involved and you take out your one-handed weapon or maybe your big two-handed sword and go in for finishing shots and things like that. But I haven't really tried to depend too much on Lydia to do a lot of the work. And part of it is that I sort of need the credit to level up. Right, so I'm going to get in there and do the dirty work myself. Yeah. But I have much work to do on learning how to use. I mean, I've got dozens of soul gems and things like that, but I have barely any shouts to try to regenerate with them. So, weapons, rather. Magic weapons that you can regenerate with soul gems.
You can make some of your own enchanted stuff, just level up enchanting.
Yeah.
Burn off some of those soul gems and get some levels in enchanting that'll help your overall character level, but it'll kind of give you a chance to play around with that that crafting skill too and see what you can do.
Yeah.
I'm assuming, have you disenchanted any weapons yet or magic items?
No.
Okay. So as you acquire magic items, you can go to any enchanter's table and then disenchant them.
Oh, really?
And you'll learn the spell.
Yeah, you'll learn the enchantment, but the item is destroyed when you do it.
But you can cast it on anything else after that point.
Yeah.
Okay, but, so you learn it and keep it forever.
Yes.
Yep. And then you can place that enchantment then on another item of your choice, provided it's the right category of item.
Sure.
Right, and so forth. Not every enchantment can go on every piece.
Yep.
Important.
So when you're playing a character who's like specialized in archery, for example, if you acquire a ring that gives you an archery bonus or something, one of the things you can do is take it to the enchanting table, disenchant it so you learn that enchantment, and then make yourself a pair of boots, a pair of gloves, a hood, all with the enchantment
stack
on them.
Stack.
That's cool. Okay. Because
so,
I have right now the amulet of Dibella for speechcraft, the amulet of Talos for decreasing shout time.
You can get all that stuff.
Yeah, you can de-enchant all.
Circlet of minor archery.
Disenchant.
Yeah.
Everything is minor. You're still a loser. We're only going to give you easy ones. Circlet of minor archery, right? So I'm trying to find as many archery-related things as I can, and I tend to load up on weapons when I've killed, vanquished my enemies.
Yes.
But then I tend to go dump them or sell them.
Right.
Right. Because if they aren't single-handed weapons like the axe.
Yeah, if they're magic, I always bring them to the enchanter and disenchant them.
When you're doing that, you're also acquiring levels
in enchanting.
That goes toward your levels.
Nice.
And that what I like about that is, when you're low level enchanting, if you acquire something that has, a 15% buff on archery, for example, if you're low level in enchanting and you make your own gear, it's leveled based on your level in enchanting.
Oh, it is. Okay.
Yeah.
So
you're not going to probably get that same.
You might get like an 8% bonus instead of the 15, but
it depends on the soul gem too.
Exactly.
It depends on the level of the soul gem. The bigger the soul gem, the more powerful the enchantment will be in the end.
Okay.
But if you create yourself, four pieces of gear that all have an 8% archery bonus on them and you're wearing them all at once, that'll stack.
Nice.
And you can have it on pieces of gear that you like instead of, Khajiit looks dumb in this, gold circlet. I don't like it. Khajiit wants to wear hood, You can do that, right? So you just put it on the stuff you want. Hood, gloves, boots, and I think... No. Yeah,
whatever. Armor, helmet, I don't know exactly.
Archery.
What that
goes archery
go
is
on.
Necklace, ring,
circlet,
headgear, and gloves.
Okay.
So basically, when you're at the enchanter, you can disenchant the item and then go into your inventory and just select either stay at the enchanter and select the enchantment, and only the things available will be. Bright.
Nice.
Everything will be grayed out.
It'll
so.
Show you exactly what you can do.
Or, if you pick a piece of armor, it'll tell you what enchantments you can put on it, that kind of thing. So you
might have been helpful for me to know that.
Now you know.
Now I know.
But you're only at level 10. So
a lot of times, if I find something...
But it's taken me 9 weeks to get to level 10.
If
at this point, I'm going to be dead by the time I catch up to your levels.
If I find something good with a decent enchantment on it, like a 30% or something... I'll usually keep that around until I'm confident I can create something that's fairly close.
Okay.
Yeah.
You disenchant items that you have enchanted, or it doesn't really matter?
Because you only can disenchant items for enchantments you don't know.
Sure. Okay.
Yeah.
So
Mm-hmm.
If you've enchanted, are there particular kinds of magical items that I should be looking for at this level?
Anything and everything, really.
Yeah. Disenchant literally everything you can get your hands on. It'll help you with levels, and then it'll give you just a bigger catalog of things to choose from. So if you get attacked by a mage, even though you're not a mage, keep his robe, disenchant it. You'll get the levels, and you'll acquire that enchantment. You may not use it in the future, but who knows?
I've got barrels full of this stuff. And I just need to go grab it, walk really slow, and go disenchant
this,
it all.
I think this is the reason, right, that you're at level 10. because
I've got them all hiding in barrels all over Skyrim.
Yeah, you're stockpiling enchanted items. If you went and disenchanted all those and learned all those enchantments,
I'd be at level 30.
You'd probably gain a few levels.
So what is an unusual gem? So I have one unusual gem I just picked up. What is
that? That's a quest item.
Yeah. Oh, I have yet to find all the unusual gems.
I have not either. In fact, it's sad to say, but I've never found all the Dragon Priest's masks either.
Oh, I've done that once.
I have not done that yet.
I've done that once.
Okay. It's insane.
But
I've got like 9 active quests right now, all of which have like 1/3 of them done, which is fine. But, you know, then I get distracted by the squirrel thing over there, so I have to go there.
Yeah, it happens.
Yeah. So, I'm with you.
But it's been fun. And while I haven't gone through the mammoth 15-hour play time that you have, I will sit down, and all of a sudden it'll be 4 hours later.
Oh, yeah. It's so easy to...
But it's great.
Yeah.
You know, the sort of cramping carpal tunnel issue is what gets me to move. I was trying to play with a regular non-gaming mouse the other day. I don't need to give any plugs for any particular gear.
Worst.
I have some preferences, but going back to, it was like a 100 DPI mouse. It was like moving all the way.
Oh, my mouse
the
is
table.
So bad. I'm afraid that if I get a good one, I'm going to suck really bad because everything's going to move so
fast. I started carrying one of those. You remember the old Razer Pro Solutions ones? They haven't sold them for a long time, but I have a few of them, and now I just carry one of them in my bag.
Yep.
I want to get a better, faster one. But.
Yeah, I've got a Mad Cat's mouse that goes with me literally. I mean, everywhere that my gaming PC goes, it comes with. And then I've got the Razer Game Mat. It's a game surface, so it's actually a piece of coated aluminum. It's like ice.
Oh,
you know,
it's so good. I have it in my bag.
There it is. Yep, I have one like that too. Mine's black, but it's. The only disadvantage is in Minnesota in the wintertime, keeping your hand on a piece of metal all day can get
some aluminum.
Like frostbite.
Don't lick it.
Yeah.
Well, don't play outside.
Yeah, I try not to put my tongue on it, but, you know, it's so hard sometimes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree. Stop playing outside in winter would be good.
What's wrong, Stu? What's going on there?
I stuck my tongue on the damn mouse pad.
Idiot.
And yes, it really happens.
Uh-huh.
So, but picking up mammoth tusks, by the way, not a problem when you're in a place where other people have slain the mammoths. It's fabulous.
Yeah.
Rather than going in and being the golf ball with the giants, which I still have not been able to get completely around.
I love that.
But just back to basics for me, it's just been
cool.
It's been so fun. I have managed to amass and throw away a huge number of lockpicks. And I also don't know what to do with the death hound collars.
I don't know. Anything? I always have a penchant for picking those up, too, just because, but I have yet to find a use for them.
It's like I need to go make a giant, scary wind chime or something.
Okay. All right.
S&M.
Yes.
No, S&M
shop.
We're going to set it up next to the Skoomaville.
Bring it
down to Skoomaville.
Yeah. We can just make some kind of a freaky strip mall outside of White Run that's got
it'd have to be down in the beggars in Markarth.
I was thinking there that, of course, I'm using the cannabis mod, so there's a shop outside White Run called Your Highness, and it could just be a strip mall there.
That would be sort of like St. Sabrina's here in town, right?
You could
the
buy your
Red District,
your Tush weed, your S&M stuff, and a little skooma vendor
there.
Come on,
buy yourself a Death Hound collar. I know you need one.
Yes. And here's our fur-lined one. Okay. Anyway,
so that's where I am. I am going to go and see between now and the next time we're here how many things I can disenchant. Okay. And we'll count how many levels I can go.
See, now the thing with the disenchant, if you can't disenchant something, it's because you already know it. So at that point, you can just go and sell it.
Stupid.
Yeah. Then sell it or throw it at someone.
So I find it funny that my own kind, the Khajiit, mm-hmm. treat me with such disdain when I come and mm-hmm. want to sell stuff to them. I know that it's just about the gameplay, but they should be like, come on, brother, we got to give you a good deal here. And instead, they're mm-hmm. treating me like Watto from Star Wars. Oh, we give you a great deal on Star Cruiser. No, give me as much cash as I want, right?
I know. It's funny. I've never had the Skyrim Khajiit experience. I'm going to have to play a Khajiit at some point, but I don't have a plan here.
I can tell you a very important bit of information. Khajiit do not always land on their feet like regular cats do. And it is possible to kill your horse by going off of a fairly steep outcropping. Yeah. That was messy and noisy, and I really needed the horse.
I've lost 3 horses by now. God, I'm so mad.
I want to know why I can't have several horses in a train carrying all of my loot.
Yeah, Joe sent me a text message this weekend with lots of expletives and stuff. And lost another horse.
Freaking bandits.
Yeah.
They keep wiping my horses out. They're expensive.
They are.
They're expensive.
And successfully stealing a horse really is a huge pain.
Well, Robard's never paid for a horse.
I don't think Robards.
It's the principle of the thing.
But see, we're learning a lot here, aren't we? Looking across the table at Robard here.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
It's horse flesh, man.
All right.
Well, thank you. That's the end of my rather lengthy
update. Good update for Whelp, right?
Oh, yes.
That's his name, right? Whelp?
For Whelp the Khajiit.
Yes. Perfect. Yeah. So you're going to do that companion's quest line.
Eventually,
I'm assuming at some point. You'll just fit right in.
Totally.
You'll be like, you've always been there. You'll feel so at home right away.
Uh-huh. All right.
All right. So,
how about you, Stu?
Yes.
I think we'd like to turn to Stu now.
Yeah, I've been playing Robbard, I don't know, just I finally decided that it was time for me to kind of get serious about building the encampment for his operation. So I busted out Tundra Defense and spent some time over the last couple of weeks pecking away at that. And I decided to actually build it at Nilheim Tower, which has proven to be kind of an interesting choice and sort of a really bad choice as well, because Nilheim is a noted spawn point for a group of bandits.
Oh.
And so, you know, Tundra Defense automatically, unless you change it, Tundra Defense will automatically spawn people to attack you. But what's been happening is I'm getting Tundra Defense spawning attacks, and
in
I'm getting
the
location itself spawning attacks, all of which are augmented by organized bandits and Genesis.
Yeah.
So it's been really messy, man.
So you've been on Berserker mode, right?
Oh my God.
Yeah. So I like that spot, though. The tower itself has been pretty cool. I actually placed the well. I took the campfire out where the campfire is normally down in there. This campsite below the tower. Mm-hmm. I disabled the campfire, and I put the well in its place. And so my entire encampment is kind of a radius from that well outward. I like the spot because the whole back part of the camp, and in fact, probably half of the camp is protected by a sheer cliff that goes, you know, that's basically where the rift drops off at that point. And it's hundreds and hundreds of feet. And so what I did is created my encampment there. So the back is covered. And then I created kind of a small harbor area where I've got some docks and my boats can come in and dock there. And then the bridge is pretty well protected. I put an outpost there, and I've laced that area with bear traps and stuff that make it pretty daunting for, you know, it's kind of funny because they're laid out in a particular pattern. And so I can have Robbard run full blast sprint across that without hitting anybody as long as I do the pattern right. You know, so he's like, you know, so then that really kind of leaves a hillside. And the hillside, I have patrolling guards on the hillside, and then there's water all along there, a river on one side and a lake on the other. So they kind of patrol the shoreline, and then I've got some interior patrol that kind of go around the buildings in there. But what's neat is I've been able to use the tools inside Tundra Defense to basically completely refurb that old broken-down tower.
Mm, cool.
So I repaired all the holes in the floor and then put an additional ceiling on it. So, and then added, so it's got my enchanting table and all that stuff. I created a third floor. So, cool. You know how that Nilheim tower is, you can take a stairway up and there's just this little platform that has a chest up there.
Mm-hmm.
I added a whole floor, that extends above the main area. So yeah, I added a bonus room to it, which is really nice because one of the things that, unless you're actually looking for it, that most people don't realize is that on the opposite side of that stairway, there's another overlook point, but you can't get to it because there's no way to get to it unless you jump up on the rim of the wall and carefully walk all the way around. So when I created that third floor, I basically connected that stairway to that section over there and then filled out the whole floor and added my enchanter's table and my alchemy table up on the third floor. Then the second floor, now it's got a roof over it. So I added in a bed there, a table and a chair. I added in some candle stands for lighting and a bookshelf. And then down on the third, on the bottom floor, I cleared that area out. And it's kind of interesting because that's where I dropped my guild starter marker. And I've recruited three people for my guild. I have Janessa, and I got Amran, and then I got Uthgerd the Unbroken. And
oh, I like her.
Yeah, they're all members of my guild now, and I made that first floor the guild headquarters, and they all kind of hang around in there. I send Janessa and Amran out on missions, but Uthgerd stays there, and I put her in like super mega. Like I tried to find the best heavy armor I could find for her, and I put her in that. And so when those bandits spawn in, they spawn in there, and Uthgerd's waiting for them, man. And she just lays waste.
And you just sit back and
perfect.
Watch.
Yeah, she's so awesome, right?
She's,
you know,
a tank.
Like you walk in there, and she's like, you know, she calls me soft gut all the time, you know. And I'm like, yeah, this is the best, you know. She's like, so funny. But yeah, I forget what mod it's from, but she's got I use the immersive armors mod, and then I put her in the Vanguard armor, and then for a weapon, she's got a massive spiked mace and a big round shield. The spiked mace is, I've never seen anything like it. It's really kind of amazing. Big, nasty looking thing. But she basically holds down the fort there. So it used to be that I was putting stationary guards in there from Tundra Defense.
Oh,
and they
just
were
getting wiped
they
out.
They were getting slaughtered all the time.
Well, they're now, too busy worried about sweet rolls. So
yeah. Now Uthgerd is in there, man, and they pop in, and they pop in, and I just have this vision in my head of, you know, her having a big toothy grin, like, come on, meat, you're mine, you know. So I cleared most of the furniture out of there, and then what I did is it was kind of fun.
You did or she did?
I did. I put in a circle of chairs. So all it is a circle of five chairs that all kind of sit in the middle of the room facing each other, and then I hung a chandelier from the ceiling. So there's like a candle chandelier that hangs right in the center of that circle. And when all of the guild members are present, they'll sit in those chairs in a circle looking at each other like they're having a meeting, you know? And it's really awesome. And then I put a spit in there with some food and a campfire and torches on the walls. And it really kind of feels like it is a guild headquarters.
That's really cool. Neat.
Yeah. I haven't dropped that yet.
Yeah.
I should do that soon.
I
kind of forgot about it, honestly.
I finally did it because I just needed to have someone protect that area because it seemed like, you know, every day I was hearing like commotion up there. And I'd go running up there. And
what
was
going on up here?
Yeah, there'd be some...
I told you kids to keep it quiet.
Some clown in there who just materialized with a battle axe and killed all my guys, you know? Like, anyway. But so that's worked out really good, though. What I've done, basically, is the objective was... This is supposed to be a smuggler's camp, so it needs to be concealed. So what I did is set it up, and in using Tundra Defense, I've used stairways and scaffolding and pallets, and basically created an entire encampment that goes down the face of the cliff. So you follow these stairways in a series of switchbacks, and every once in a while, there's a platform with something going on. So there's one platform that's big enough. I constructed it big enough that it has the general store on it.
Oh, cool. Wow.
Yeah, and another one that you go way around, kind of down the cliff and around a remote corner. And at the bottom, there's a platform where you can get access to the mine, which is carved right into the side of the cliff. It's very cool, and I was able to use platforms to create... if you're familiar with how Nilheim Tower works, this is the place where that bandit Telrav will tell you that he's been attacked and he's in trouble, and will you escort him to his camp and all that stuff. Mm. And it turns out to be a trap, but he has you cross this bridge, and you have to cross the bridge over a waterfall. It's a really narrow bridge to get you to the campsite. So what I actually did is... came down the back of the cliff and created a series of wood walkways that take you all the way around to the cliff to a point where you can stand and look up at the bridge from around there.
Oh, nice.
And what's been interesting is I've learned about Tundra Defense is it is a full 360 degree. It's basically a sphere around your starting point, not a flat circle, right? So I'm able to build down and up as well inside that space. So as I was building out and I was running into the outside edges of my usable space, I started going on the cliff and building down and around. And it's turned out really awesome. So
I was going to ask if there were any unintended consequences of doing that. And it sounds like you found one of them, right? A good one. Any unintended consequences that are bad, not in your favor?
Well, I think one of the issues, of course, is that when I'm doing this, I'm adding a very elaborate structure with a lot of new items and models to the space. So far, performance has been really actually pretty good inside the smuggler's camp. I was having some trouble over the weekend with crashes to desktop, but I've determined that those were actually, I think, because of Climates of Tamriel. There's something going on with my Climates of Tamriel setup, because the one thing that they all seemed to have in common was that there was some major weather event going on when I would crash to desktop.
Okay.
So I don't really, in the end, I don't think it has anything to do with
I haven't noticed any kind of performance, but then again, in the area I chose, it's dark. I don't have the same type of lighting effects and all that, although I've been trying to scatter as many torches around as possible. But
there is an advantage in being able to be a Khajiit and not have to have the torches.
That's true.
Well, as a vampire, I don't need them either, but my people do.
Robbard needs him. He's constantly cursing the fact that he can't see, you know, like...
I thought that was because he was lit for a totally different reason.
Yeah. Well, yeah. That's the interesting thing, too, here, is I'm I think it's okay for me to make an official announcement here. My plan is that I am going to use Robbard as the basis to launch a new Skyrim Let's Play that will focus on Robbard specifically. Mm. And I'm trying to get him to a point where I feel like he's leveled where I need him to be. This is not a start from beginning Let's Play. In fact, I don't know that I'd even call it a Let's Play. It's going to be a Couch Warrior style Let's Play. But I've come up with a format that will allow me to do this and do it within the structure I've created for myself or the time limits I've created for myself. Now, what it means is I'm probably going to end up once again pulling back on Dark Messenger and pulling back on Anthology and, you know, things like that. But this will allow me to do some storytelling and do it you know, in Couch Warrior style using this character. So once the story kicks off, my guess is he's probably going to be about level 40 when the story kicks off. So what I'm doing now is kind of setting the stage for that. And for me to do what I want to do is it just requires me to test a lot of mods, try some things out. Cool. And what I'm kind of doing is building the set pieces that I'll use to tell my story. Sure. So,
more later.
Yeah. So you can look forward to that. It's going to be story driven. Things will be scripted, not to the extent that they were. There will be scripted pieces and then unscripted pieces. There will be supporting characters and other things going on, just like a Couch Warrior Let's Play should be. But it's going to be, Robbard will be the focus of this first one. So there will be some warnings for mature language and so forth. I'm not going to hold back with this character, so it'll be kind of fun. And I'm going to try to role play it a bit more. So there's going to be, I think, more sort of on the fly voice acting and just kind
of
general fun.
Yeah,
I think, I'm kind of looking forward to it. So I've been trying a lot of different things just to see what works, what would be fun.
Very cool.
Let it out, man.
Yeah.
But to clarify, I mean, this isn't going to be a production like the Aranus.
No.
No, this is a play along of whatever.
Is a real... Yeah. More true to the term.
Yep. This is a story-driven and role-play-driven Let's Play. But while some pieces will be scripted and there will be cutscenes for them, it is going to be done in more of a consistent sort of formulaic way. Each episode will start with a cutscene that sets the episode up that will be anywhere from 2 to 5 minutes long, and then we'll proceed to the Let's Play. And during the Let's Play, I'll introduce some role play aspects that are kind of off the cuff role play. But the intro scenes will help set up each piece. And that way, I can limit the amount of time that I spend doing video production and script writing for each episode.
Right.
So I don't have a release date yet, but plans are in the works. So.
Sweet.
Yes.
Very nice.
All right. Well, it sounds to me like we are ready to move on to play theory. OP equals BS, people. Stick around. Welcome to Play Theory, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight, the theme is OP equals BS. And before we get into the discussion, I thought that I would just give everybody a little bit of rundown on what my theory is about this. Why are we talking about this?
Do you have a
topic?
Theory? Let's hear your theory.
It is play theory, after all.
I thought it was play theory. Where's the emphasis go?
On the wrong syllable, apparently. So, one of the things that's always bothered me is that we have a lot of people out on the Nexus who are building really great mods. And then what'll happen is some clown will come into the comments and say, oh, this is overpowered, blah, blah, blah. It's game breaking. It's this and that and the other thing. And that whole argument has always bothered me because I think just as there are infinite ways in this game that you can make it more interesting for role play or whatever it is your objective is, there are so many other ways that you can make the game more challenging.
Right.
And so I think that this whole discussion of this spell is overpowered, this mod's overpowered, this piece of armor or enchantment is overpowered, I think it's a little bit of a false position. And so what I wanted to do is take an opportunity in tonight's play theory segment to talk a little bit about this idea of not just mods that might be overpowered. That's not really the focus here. The focus is what can you do in game to set the stage for any mod that you want to use.
Right.
So if a mod is an extremely powerful mod, who cares?
What's the context?
Yeah.
How does it fit?
What is the context? Yes. How does it fit? And what can we do in our game to make it fit, to make it work? Because I think that there are a lot of mods out there, and this particularly happens, I think, with a lot of spell mods, where people say that, you know, a collection of spells is overpowered. Well, you know, that you have to take that in context. It's only overpowered if your objective is to really just go and kill everybody in Whiterun, then fine. You know, you're playing a character intentionally overpowered. But if you're a role player, that means nothing. In the idea of overpowered or game breaking means nothing, because there are other ways that you can increase the challenge. So that kind of sets the stage for what this conversation is about. And for me, it's really showing our support in a way to those people who are taking the time to create some really cool mods, only to have someone come into the comments on Nexus and basically poo-poo what it is they're building because they say it's overpowered or game-breaking. I just don't buy that.
I think some people just got to ruin the world with some negative comments.
Yeah, but well, some folks are like that. But
some folks are like that.
That's
wet
okay.
blanket on the campfire, whatever.
That's right.
But seriously, I mean, I don't know how long it takes for you to make the micro mods, right? For folks who are building some of these epic game-changing mods, there's some effort. To be hundreds and hundreds of hours of time that goes into planning and building them. Just the simple fact that someone's got the courage to publish it.
Yep.
Huge kudos from me.
Yeah.
You want to come out and criticize it? I say the same thing. If you complain about the people running for office, you think you can do better, you better do it.
Exactly.
You know, and I would love to see more people do more mods and find out what you think is worthwhile. Publish it.
Right, exactly.
Don't stand there and criticize.
Well, as we often do during our play theory segments, I'm going to start by giving a specific example of this. And then we can kind of go from there. One of the mods that I think is very interesting, and one of my recent characters, we've talked about him in early episodes, is Julian. Julian Wingate Bitteridge.
Yep.
he is very interested in Dwemer
yes.
science and technology, right? Well, there's a mod out there that uses pieces from the vanilla game of Dwemer artifacts to create essentially what's an exoskeleton that you can get into, you can wear it, and it gives you enhanced abilities, enhanced physical abilities, speed and strength, and all these kind of different things, right? And there have been a whole series of videos on it and stuff like that, and the term that keeps coming up all the time is how powerful it is, and that it's overpowered, and that it's game breaking, and that it's this and that and the other thing. And that has always bothered me because I think I have a hard time believing that even in an exoskeleton like that, if I enhance the AI and I increase the difficulty of my game, and then I drop in a game like or a mod like Elemental Dragons, that I am not going to get trashed over and over and over again by very powerful creatures. So, you know, it bothers me a little bit to see something like that, to see what is essentially a really cool mod. You can build this exoskeleton by gathering the parts and things like that. It's really very cool, but to see people kind of down on it because they think it's overpowered. And I think there's, you know, that's an objective thing, you know, whether or not.
I don't mean to be cruel. I just keep thinking of the word whiners. Because I can think of so many ways that you could make the game harder, commensurate with the capability of the mod.
Yeah.
I agree with it. That's a total pile of bull.
And I think, depending on the kind of character you're playing, certain mods like that, for example, the exoskeleton, that could be the centerpiece of an entire playthrough.
Totally.
where you say that, you know, the end game for my character is that he is going to be the smartest guy in the world who is able to uncover the secrets of the Dwemer and build this fantastical thing. Mm-hmm. We're talking about a game that includes lore about things like the Numidium, which was a giant apocalyptic robot, basically, built by the Dwemer that can destroy everything, right?
So it fits right in.
It very well could. You could tie it into the Ethereal Wars and all that good stuff.
Absolutely.
I mean, there's
there's Dwemer, a challenge right there.
The Dwemer is really cool.
Mm-hmm. Somebody's epicosity project ought to be that.
Yeah.
Sure. Why not?
Yeah. Well, there's no reason at all that something like, you know, an exoskeleton mod like that can't be the centerpiece of somebody's playthrough, the centerpiece for the right character.
Right.
Or, you know, any other mod for that matter. So if there's a super powerful weapon or a piece of armor that maybe that's
make it the center gem of your collection or whatever. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, something like that, right?
Or like a set of armor that's really cool and you get something different. You go put it on the mannequin. Maybe this is something that you search out and you try to build and maybe use it a couple times for whatever reason your character might have, and then you just put it in your museum.
Right. Well, typically the core of that argument, of the OP or game-breaking argument, is always that it makes the game too easy. And I think if one of the things that we can say about Skyrim is if we were to compare Skyrim to a lot of other games that come out, whether they're first-person shooters or, you know, RTS type games or whatever, Skyrim does not rank very high in the challenge level, period. Even if you're playing at Legendary. I mean, honestly, if I invest in the right skills and I, you know, do my own crafting and I'm playing a stealth character and I'm making my own bow and enchanted gear, I get to a point pretty quickly, you know, by level 30 or 40, where I can one-shot a lot of stuff, even on Legendary. So I don't think that at its core, Skyrim was designed with the idea that the primary focus was going to be on how challenging it was going to be.
Right.
The primary focus, I think, on a game like Skyrim has always been about the experience and about how the player feels. You're supposed to feel heroic. It's supposed to be, it's a role-playing game. And so while the game needs to be challenging in order to be engaging, I think that the game can be challenging without your character having to die over and over and over again. Right?
Stop pointing at me.
What?
I keep dying all the time. A little bit of armor wouldn't be such a bad thing.
A lot would be even better.
A lot of armor. Mm-hmm.
No, but I can see a situation where you would go from dying all the time, like I have been, right? I call it experience. Mm-hmm. to wanting to try something like that out and feeling like, oh, I'm king of the universe now.
But yep.
Then you look back on it and say, I don't know that I really learned anything from playing, right?
Right.
And that's where I think that taking your example, Joe, there's a really good opportunity to try it. Maybe it's part of some of your quests, maybe something like that. You don't have to feel bad about your decision to try the mod.
No.
And that's where
if it doesn't fit your character, don't use it.
Exactly.
And if you don't have a character, then use it all you want. If you have a character that you're trying to role play through the game, you have a little bit different, emotional proximity to your character.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, you're going to feel guilty about taking on something that isn't yours, right?
Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt.
No, that's all right.
No, I think it's, you know, I think where I get offended is like when somebody feels the need then to go out on the Nexus and be dickish about it, you know? So, I mean, that's...
Yeah, I mean, I guess if you're going to go to that length to express your opinion, back it up with something.
Right.
Why? Mm-hmm. Or give some constructive criticism. Most mod authors are actually really receptive to new ideas or some criticisms. Maybe there's a bug somewhere, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But to just come out and say, this sucks, it's overpowered, and just say nothing else.
Yeah, well, the key is...
no one any good.
Yeah, it's overpowered for your game and whatever your friggin' play style is, you know, but why it's is not it necessarily for everyone else, right? So...
open that dialogue, and then people can start making better decisions on whether it's something that they want to try or not.
Yeah.
And it may have saved somebody else's game.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you go in there and all of a sudden you feel guilty because someone else said it was too much.
Yeah.
It's the only thing in
the
world.
Well, there's two sides to this argument all the time, too, and it's so annoying, right? On the one hand, you'll have a person say, oh, you know, the exoskeleton mod is overpowered and it makes my character too powerful. But then at the same time, they'll look at a mod like Elemental Dragons and they'll say, oh, no, the enemies are too powerful. Well, you're just never going to be friggin' happy then, are you?
Right.
So let's talk about, let's this is a play theory segment. Let's get into something practical for Skyrim role players, which is let's talk about ways that you can increase the challenge presented by the game. I've been playing for a long time now, and so I can gauge pretty quickly what is the right level for me in just the vanilla game settings. And, you know, I don't always play at master or legendary level. A lot of times when I start a character, because I'm getting to know them and figuring out how I want to play them, you know, I'll start them at adept or expert level. And then over time, every 10 levels or so, I'll bump up the vanilla difficulty. But that's, you know, that's something that anybody can do in the vanilla game.
I don't even know and that I've ever changed it.
The effect there is, it's not stunning, right? I mean, essentially, it doesn't make your enemies any smarter. What it does is give them more hit points.
And basically.
They do more damage, right?
Right.
So once you up that, you may get one-shotted by... bandit archers more often and stuff like that, right? Which is fine, but there are other ways to increase the difficulty with mods, increase the challenge, right?
Right. So. Well, the bandit mod, OBIS.
Yes, Organized bandits in Skyrim.
Correct. Yep. I found that to be a really good mod just
love
because,
it.
One, the variety of the bandits, and each type of bandit has a unique skill set, and they're tough. I mean, they're smart. They stay angry a lot longer.
Yep.
And they will find you eventually if you're not, you know, actively moving around quietly.
Right. Yeah.
I'm playing on expert, by the way.
That's fine.
That's good.
I personally, awesome. For a long time, I played, I think, on the lowest, whatever that is, just until I got a feel for the game and. Quite honestly, at the time,
like toddler or something,
I kind of liked
novice.
Being the boss. You know, it was it was fun at the time, and then now I got more experience with the game. You know, I bumped that up.
I'm thrilled that I've been playing on expert.
Yeah, I mean that's great.
No shame, now
right?
Being
so
killed hundreds of times.
A game like OBIS, Organized Bandits in Skyrim, like you're saying, yes, it does increase the difficulty. I think it slightly improves the AI of the bandits. It allows you to throttle up and down the number of bandits that appear and the frequency with which they appear. But the other thing it does from role-playing a sense is, like you're saying, it adds more varieties, and you see the bandits use all kinds of interesting and unique magic more often.
Right.
I love the idea that the bandits kind of form factions. Like really weird and kind of interesting factions.
Yeah, some more difficult than others, but
I
agree.
Absolutely. And they'll do things like they'll use poisons. I encountered a group of bandits not too long ago where there was one woman in this bandit clan who had to be at least a foot taller than all the rest
of them.
I've
come across a few, that are way bigger than me.
Yeah, and she had a huge warhammer, and I was scared to death of her, man. You know, so yes, OBIS is a great one, and another related one is Genesis.
Okay, I'm not familiar with that one.
Genesis, what it does is it will, for example, in a dungeon, it'll take a look at all, it basically surveys all the enemies that are in that type of dungeon, and it will dynamically create more enemies and spawn them in,
right.
But it's smart enough to kind of spread them out throughout the entire dungeon
I've looked at this before.
Yeah, and instead of having a crowd appear in all in one place. So
surprise!
Yeah, I know. What? So if you feel like, you know, the dungeons are too sparsely populated, Genesis is a great way to do that, but it doesn't impact immersion because it takes what's already in that area. If it's a bandit focused cave, then there's more bandits. If it's Draugr, there's more Draugr. And I've found that with Genesis, some interesting things have happened too, where I've had instances where I've gone into locations where the bandits are, and Genesis has spawned bandits behind me.
Ooh.
But it didn't just spawn them behind me. It actually had them come in through the door.
Which
totally
they usually
made sense.
Never do.
Yeah, it totally made sense, right?
Another one that I had immersive creatures installed.
Okay.
And that just throws in a slew of new and different creature characters,
right,
and NPCs, or NPCs rather, based on the terrain and the area. So, but I actually disengaged that one just because it was starting to get some kind of really weird, like almost like land-based dragons, that kind of stuff. Some of the creatures were a little too weird for me.
Okay.
But yeah, that one specifically, and I can't remember what it was called, but it was basically like a dragon on land, and it just chased me all over the place. I had a hell of a time getting...
Wow.
Bringing that thing down. But what I was getting to for this, because that one also includes the armored skeletons.
Okay.
So what I had done is I took that immersive creatures mod out, because also I was getting like reclines in the
really?
Snowy areas and stuff. And I'm like, you know, that's weird. They shouldn't be here.
Okay. They were in areas that didn't have snow?
No, they were in the snowy areas, but they were on the mainland.
They were on Skyrim.
Yeah.
They were in Skyrim.
Yeah. And I'm like, it didn't feel right. So
okay. That
just seems like a real Solstheim
thing
to me. And they shouldn't be on this side of the water.
Okay.
But I took that out, but there's another mod that specifically is for the armored skeletons.
Okay.
So I installed that because that's actually what I wanted. So what that does is that actually adds, like it says, skeletons that are in armor.
Okay.
They're a little tougher? They're tougher, and they can also potentially reanimate.
Oh, wow.
So if you bring one down, it'll start to come back, and it'll come back at you.
Oh, my gosh.
And there's different types of skeletons, like necromantic skeletons, mage skeleton, that kind of thing with spell casting.
All right. So this is a big enhancement of kind of that whole undead space.
Yeah, and it's specific to skeletons in this particular case, so not the Draugr or anything. But,
okay.
So it makes those creatures a lot more difficult.
Yeah, I like that.
And the fact that they can come back on you after you whack them, it's just kind
of a pisser.
Just
when you thought it was safe.
Yeah, that's a little disconcerting, right?
Yeah, but they do look cool because they have some nice, you know, they look better with, because it makes sense that,
right,
you know, the flesh is gone, but armor wouldn't have disappeared.
But it seems to me like getting uncomfortable with a game that you're comfortable with is like exactly what you would want to do. Case like that, right?
Yeah, I would think so. And so what I think the classification of mod that we're talking about right now are kind of enemy enhancements, right? These are enhancements of the enemies, whether they're
either adding more or making them a little smarter, or
creatures
more
difficult or humanoid,
or a combination.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's one way.
That's one way. Yep.
And adjusting the difficulty in the game itself is another way. Another way we can do this, of course, is we can introduce something like a combat mod. So I'm using a mod called Ultimate Combat, and that introduces, a bit more AI challenge with enemies. So when you're actually in combat with enemies, they will do more dodging, they will do more blocking. They will, you know, they react in a more interesting and varied way.
Sure.
So they will kind of pay attention to what's going on with you, and they will press the attack if they feel like they have an advantage, or they may pull back if they feel like they need to, right?
I may not have noticed that without thinking about it, right?
Mm-hmm. I mean, to me, there are several mods out there that will enhance the combat AI. This one I particularly, I chose to use this one because one of the other ones I was considering interfered with player head tracking, which to me is essential for role play. But this one enhances the overall combat AI, which also includes some headshot capability stuff like that. So, you know, and it's not just me. I mean, I'm headshotting enemies, but they are headshotting me as well. and when you combine that mod with a mod like Organized Bandits, which introduces bandits into the game like Steel Shots, for example, who is a kind of a grouping of bandits that are bow specialists, and they're really like deadly. And we introduce this kind of headshot mechanism.
Oh yeah,
right?
It makes sense to pair them.
Yeah,
totally. I mean, it really does.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, so
there's this whole classification of combat AI mods, right? And there's a bunch of them out there that you can choose, and many of them will work together in concert with one another.
Right.
So that's another way, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, what else can we do to increase the difficulty? We can look for mods like, for example, we'd mentioned earlier, Elemental Dragons, which introduces
a bunch of different ones, a bazillion
new variations on the dragons, some of which are extremely
really
powerful
difficult.
That can spawn other enemies and
right.
can do all kinds of crazy things.
What about environmental mods?
Yeah, environmental mods, we can increase the difficulty there too.
Right? Frostfall, you can certainly jack yourself up on that one.
Yeah, absolutely. So we introduce Frostfall, and now let's say we're suffering from hypothermia, and then we get attacked.
Right. Oh, yeah. No, I've...
Right?
Yeah, I've been there.
It's terrible.
Yeah.
I mean, if you really want to get hardcore, man...
if you really want to get hardcore, Frostfall and turn on so you can freeze to death.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, the environment will literally kill you then at that point. You get too cold and you die.
Is it...
Totally...
Is it,
it's just like going outside here in winter.
Mm-hmm.
Is it climates that will, like a snowstorm, will blind you?
Yep.
So
climates of Tamriel will create blinding snowstorms and rainstorms.
So if you get attacked while you're in hypothermia with a snowstorm and you can't see Jack...
You're so screwed.
You're really screwed.
Really
I don't
sorry.
Care what your exoskeleton
Where
has on
Where was
it.
Your spawn
I know,
point?
I know, right? So, yeah, I mean, the environment can be the greatest antagonist in the world,
realistic
especially
needs
Skyrim,
and diseases.
So.
Does that add?
Yep. Realistic needs and diseases will add things like enhanced disease effects. You can get food poisoning. You can, you know, there's all kinds of things there. You can suffer from, you know, deprivation from water and food.
Sure.
Cool.
Things like that, right?
I have one called First Aid that I just put in, and I'll have to do a little more research on it, but that one I believe will affect the rate of which you heal if you're injured badly.
Okay.
And so, but it gives you the ability to create bandages that you can use for first aid.
Oh, nice.
But, excuse me, you can't use them during combat.
Right.
You have to wait till you're away.
Oh, you have to survive combat so you can treat yourself.
Yep.
That's really great. That's a great example.
Over powerful. You're ruining the game.
I'll look up the more details on it, but it's on the Nexus. But it's been really cool. You can create the bandages and it'll heal up like 15 points or whatever it is. So
yeah, great.
And that depending on what you use, like a meat or an ale to make them at like a cooking pot.
Yep.
They'll also act like as an antiseptic.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Wow. You can suffer
from
infection.
Actually.
Yeah, I haven't really gotten into the meat of the mod, but...
Yeah, interesting.
Yeah.
Well, I think on a related note, I recently started using a mod called Archery Gameplay Overhaul, and that one actually has an effect where when you get shot with an arrow, the arrow stays. It doesn't just go away eventually. you actually have to, like, pull the arrow out.
So you look like a porcupine.
Potentially.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, in playing Robbard fighting bandits, right? I finished out that battle with an arrow like sticking through my leg. Now, there's certain things you can turn on and off in the game. It the fact that the arrows are there doesn't affect you so much, but there is a bleed effect that you can toggle on and off that will cause some extra damage. And then you essentially get what's the equivalent of a power. And when you execute this power, he'll like bend over and wrench the arrows out and like, you know, and stuff like that. And so he would pull the arrows out and it would say, okay, you've removed the arrow and now this wound is healing or whatever.
Oh, that's a great
touch. But see, matching that with some of these first aid ones, it would feel...
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
You know, forced rest, that kind of thing.
Yeah, right. If nothing else, great for role playing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Now, one of the things that I think is really interesting is that with this mod, and this is going to actually, I think, play a fairly large role in my upcoming work with Robbard, is that archery gameplay overhaul mod also has an option you can toggle on and off for trembling of your arm when you're at full pull on the bow.
Oh, sweet.
That's kind of neat.
So I've toggled that on, and the longer I hold the bow, the worse the tremors get, to the point where it's, you know, caused me to miss before because I've had the string pulled back for too long.
That's curious because with your perk... The longer, I mean, if you hold it for at least 5 seconds, you're going to get a better damage or better shot.
Yep.
But if you hold it for 5 seconds, you're going to start wobbling.
Your chances of missing are greater, right? Which makes perfect sense.
That's a great trade-off.
But then that way you're not walking around with the bow pulled all the time.
Exactly. Yeah. And when you consider the fact that, you know, he's using a sizable recurve bow with a 120-pound pull, you can't hold that at your ear for very long before, you know, it's time to release the tension, right? So stuff like that, I think, is really cool. And that, so I think we've crossed over here a little bit. There's some environment types of mods, some additional combat enhancement mods, right?
Right.
I mean, one of the complaints I think you hear a lot besides just magic is that everybody eventually ends up defaulting to the bow because the bow is so powerful in the game. I think there are ways to enhance that. What I've done is between Knock the Tip and Archery Gameplay Overhaul, I've basically, even though I'm using Percus Maximus, I've disabled my ability to hold the string back without draining stamina.
Hmm.
Yeah. And then I'm adding the tremor.
Right.
And if I can have all these combat enhancements in plus play at master difficulty with enhanced creatures and all this stuff going on, and I can still hit my targets at full pull, I feel like I deserve the kill. You know what I mean?
No kidding.
Yeah, right? I agree.
So,
out of curiosity, I'm toying with the idea of crossing over to the crossbow for Ienarath.
Okay.
Do you know what kind of effects your bow enhancement might have for a crossbow? Or
I don't believe that it
I mean, it wouldn't seem like it should have the same types because you're locking the string in.
No, archery, the archery combat overhaul, I don't believe has any significant effect on that.
For the crossbow, okay.
And for the most part, what the overhaul does is it introduces a lot of new bow animations.
Oh, okay.
So if you look at the last episode of Dark Messenger, you'll notice that now when he's running with the bow, he's actually holding the bow downward perpendicular to himself with an arrow knocked and his fingers on the string, and he runs forward that way.
Okay.
And when he pulls and draws, he's actually much more erect and he's pulling straight back to his ear. It's more of a natural kind of position, looking archery position. And then it introduces some optional abilities you can toggle on and off for alternate hand-to-hand combat options where he can actually just take the arrow he's got in his hand and stab someone with it.
Which seems,
when they're
again,
opposed.
Totally reasonable, right? Instead of having to change weapons. If that was your choice, that's what you would do.
Yeah. Yeah. So I've been messing around a little bit. I mean, I wanted to introduce more challenge into my gameplay because I'm a big lover of archery and, you know, bow or range-based combat, particularly the bow.
Right.
With your arrow sustain or whatever you call it, does it stay visible in your opponents as
well? Yes, it does.
Yeah.
It does. And what it does is it gives me the option now, right? I when I want to retrieve my arrows, I have to go up to a dead enemy, and I use this option, and he'll actually crouch down over the enemies and try to wrench the arrows out.
That's cool.
And some of the arrows I get back, and then some of them snap off whatever. But it just adds sort of a level of detail.
Yeah, that's a nice. That's a really nice mod.
Yeah, I like that one a lot.
It's way too powerful. I just have to tell you, it's way too powerful. I could never use that. It would ruin the game.
It's OP and game breaking.
You'd never hit anything.
Okay, well, so stop calling out what would really happen.
Now you're...
Yeah.
I've been trying to run with this thing, ready to go for 15 minutes.
There are a lot of mods out there that are specifically created to make the game more challenging. The thing I like about the class of mods like archery... gameplay overhaul is that there's a lot of things in the MCM menu that you can change yourself.
Yeah, I've discovered that it seems like more and more mod authors are utilizing the mod configuration.
Thank God.
Which is great. It's really nice to be able to toggle different options off like that or set different things.
Again, it just takes more programming time.
Absolutely.
Yes. You have to be very considerate of what you should be able to do. But
Yes.
Yep. And I think one of the things that is great about this mod in particular is it gives the archer, the player, a lot of control over the camera position and the position of the reticle.
Oh, okay.
When you're playing in third person. And I always play... Whenever possible, I play in third person, especially when I'm recording, because it gives a better sense of character. Mm-hmm. But when I'm actually playing, I play in third person as well. And I go into first person for searching and stuff, but that's about it.
Interesting.
So what you can do, though, is use the mod to make adjustments vertically and horizontally to the camera position over your character's shoulder. So what I've done on Dark Messenger... is had the camera drift a bit higher to the upper right, so I can get a clearer view of the battlefield.
Right.
But then I've had to manually adjust my reticle to get it back into the right position. Using a tool like that, you could even make some artificial wonkiness, built into the way the reticle is positioned that challenge you to compensate. So... when you're out shooting a gun or shooting a bow and you're shooting long distances and stuff like that, you're doing things like, compensating for wind.
That's why people go to the ranges
for
so
the
that
drop,
they can calibrate their
for the drop
shots.
Of the projectile. And so, what I did is, went to a target and then spent some time trying to dial it in at different ranges, right? Mm. And so I've kind of got things dialed in, but you can use that if you want to make it more challenging.
I found that even just in the vanilla mechanics between the bow and the crossbow.
Yep.
My crossbow sight line is way different than my bow shot.
Yeah.
And
absolutely.
I'm glad I actually was messing around with it, and I had a target nearby. And otherwise, if I would have gone into combat with the crossbow, I would have been missing everything.
Mm-hmm.
They would have been going way high and up to the right.
Yeah, for sure.
But
these are all great ideas. I think if a person were to do, add some unique and interesting enemies, enhance the combat AI, add some things from some of these mods that are unique to your character, make the environment an antagonist in your story, that all those things together could make a game extremely challenging without even touching the game.
Sometimes. Just on top of that, along with the one, a thing that we mention, fairly frequently, and that's, character limitations.
Yeah.
Don't always use the biggest and the best because it's available.
Mm-hmm.
Use what your character would use.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I can certainly go out and make the best set of Daedric armor that I would ever want to make, but my character wouldn't be caught dead in that crap. So
I agree.
If I'm deciding that I'm not going to put emphasis on something like smithing, and I've decided that what I'm going to wear is a set of leather ranger's armor, and I'm going to specialize in the bow and a short sword, well, then I have to make my tactics account for the equipment that I've chosen to use. Yeah.
And well, and even with my character now, she's wearing heavy armor. Mm-hmm. She's got a really nice set of heavy plate. It's the Spellbinder armor.
Okay.
Looks great, but I found a really nice vampire-themed set of armor, a mod that I installed, and it's kind of like the Chaos Forge, so you can craft it in that similar way.
Oh, sure.
But it's all light.
Is this the Lustmourne?
Yeah.
Armor?
Yeah. I like it. I think it's going to be really good for that for her character.
Right.
And that's why I brought up the crossbow, because in that set is a crossbow option.
Yes.
And it's kind of a sexy crossbow.
Yeah. That crossbow, the Lustmourne crossbow, is the crossbow that we see Sumerian using in my previews for Act 4.
But I think I'm going to don her with that armor. Yeah. I got to go get the right ingredients or the right stuff to make it all, but... that means I'm going down from, I'm downgrading in my protection.
Yep. You know, so much of this is really about role play. I mean, if I just want to run across Skyrim trying to find harder and harder things to kill, I'm probably going to be disappointed all the time, you know, but I mean, if my goal is really about role play, if I really care about role play, and like you're saying, Matt, I'm restricting myself to that steel family sword, right? Yeah. And I'm playing at level 50, and I've literally, crafted it as far up as I can possibly craft
got
it.
Got as much of enchantment on it as it can take.
And... but I'm facing opponents who are coming at me at, level 50 or 60 with Daedric weapons or something like that. Right. Then,
you have to do it a different way.
There's my challenge right there.
Exactly.
And I think... a lot of this has to do with some of the concepts we've talked about before about self-imposed weaknesses or vulnerabilities.
I know we've said it before, but it's something that we're going to continually come around to because it's all about the character.
Absolutely. So I think that we're seeing that, playing out with your character.
It's developing that way.
Yeah. She's making decisions based on what's best for her.
She's definitely kind of come around in a different way than I originally envisioned, and that's all right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You're seeing her personality come out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean, the core of a great character starts with their vulnerabilities, and those vulnerabilities can be physical, and they can be psychological, and sometimes it's hard in this game to play up a physical, to physical disability. What I've chosen to do with Robbard is play that physical disability by using some of the options inside Archery Gameplay Overhaul to add the tremble, right? Because in my mind, that's not just Robbard, trying to hold back string for too long. But it's Robbard suffering from the long-term effects of all of his years of fighting and probably untreated ailments. Mm-hmm. And, we're probably talking about things like joint disease. There's a reason why he's...
Rock joint.
There's a reason why. Yeah, I mean, we'll see it come to light in the Let's Play because... It's imperative that I understand the character and why he's gotten into this whole skooma thing in the first place and why he's always smoking and stuff, because it calms the tremble, from years of, of fighting and abuse of his body and untreated ataxia and stuff like that has left his nervous system in a bit of a shambles, and he compensates for that by ingesting narcotics or whatever he can do, right? And so by doing that, right, I'm introducing a limitation on myself because every time I take skooma, my abilities are enhanced, but then I suffer the crash later.
Yeah, coming down is certainly.
Right.
Can't talk coming down.
Yep. And then the self-imposed trembling, right? That's another thing. It's making it more difficult for me to use the bow, but the bow is what he knows.
But again, we identify more with the character and the story when there is that frailty. yeah. built in. If you're completely, you
giving
know,
them a human element.
Yeah.
Yeah. If all you want to do is play on God mode, that's totally different. You know, yeah. that's going
there's
through
a console
slaughtering
command
everything.
For that if you really want.
Different objective.
No.
You know, so there you go.
So
maybe 20 years ago I'd want that, but not now.
Well, it all plays together, right?
Yeah.
So there are infinite ways that we can make this game more challenging for us. And some of that we do ourselves through role play. Some we can do through mods. Some we can do through just plain old game settings. And I think that all of this serves to kind of invalidate this idea that a mod can be overpowered. If you decide that you want to, you know, role play, then you go ahead and do that. And maybe there's a spell package that is very powerful, but maybe you find a way through role play to limit which spells you use and how you use them, right? And, placing those kinds of interesting restrictions on yourself are what make the game fun and unique every time you play it, but also make it challenging. So
now if we could take some of those mods and force them on our fellow players.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there's so many mods in my mix right now, and there's so many that I love, and I'm having trouble shedding any.
That essential list just keeps growing, doesn't it?
Yeah, it really kind of does.
So what would happen if someone said that you could only do 10?
Well, that would be a tough choice.
I'd have to start with 100 for you right now.
You know, what I'd probably do is try to pick one from each category. So give me one environmental enhancement that I can't live without. Mm-hmm. And one NPC enhancement and one armor and weapon enhancement, and go through that first and try to get my favorites in each category and then see if I got any slots left over. But yeah, so we hope you've enjoyed this conversation. Let us know either in the comments on the website or send us an email what ideas you have for increasing game challenge, what things that you've tried to do, and maybe we'll talk about that in a future episode. And just an interesting item of note here. In October, we're going to be recording an episode. I'm very excited about it. We're going to be recording an episode with a gentleman named Alistair Stevens, who is an expert on character development for stories and literature. He does seminars on the topic. I have attended one of his seminars, and it was freaking amazing. And he's also a gamer. And we are going to talk about character development in game and some of the things that we can do to go even deeper and work on the foundation of our characters through vulnerability and goals and objectives and all that stuff. So I'm very excited about that. Yeah, that'll be coming in October. I think right now we're scheduled to talk to Alistair on the 12th. So,
story development mods.
Yes, it's going to be amazing.
Oh.
All right.
Good time.
Nice.
All cool. right. So it sounds like we got some listener questions, so stick around for the next segment. Okay, it's time for Crusader Mail. That is where you get to send us questions and we get to answer them, which is our privilege. What do we have tonight, Joe?
All right. We've got a couple related ones to just kind of... stuck.
Okay.
Need a little help and some ideas. So let's start out with Andre. Andre von Berlin.
Okay.
Berlin. Andre, I won't grace you with my really bad German, but so we'll read this in English since your English is way better than my German, no doubt.
Mm-hmm.
He writes, or... she, I guess. No, it'd be a he.
Okay.
I'm stupid. I'll
take your word for it.
Well, maybe pretty not. Sure Andre.
Are you taking his word that he's stupid or what?
No comment.
I think yes is probably a good answer.
Yes.
I've completed the main quest line and the Dark Brotherhood quest line with my Red Guard Archer Assassin, Azam. However, I've come to a point where I'm not quite sure what to do. I know I want to explore the DLC quest lines, which I've actually not done, but also as my character is a devout cultist or cultist-esque worshiper of Mephala, I'd like to make Azam her champion in the future. However, Mephala's blade is a two-handed weapon, And while I feel it might make for a very versatile playstyle if I could integrate two-handed in the future, I'm not quite sure how to do it smoothly. I've considered finding a good follower that I could roleplay as if they are teaching me and perhaps I teach them sneaking or archery. What are your opinions or ideas? If it helps, the character is at level 25.
Okay. Interesting. Well, first
and
of all...
just as a note, this is a PC player.
Okay. So this person can use mods.
Yep.
Okay. Well, first of all, I like the idea that after having completed a couple of quests, this person who is obviously very serious about their worship of Mephala would consider a completely new combat style to pay homage or to honor their god. That gets right at the heart of what we've been talking about with character weakness or vulnerability.
Right.
We're introducing our own kind of artificial restriction on certain things by, you know, saying that, okay, you know, we're going to follow this path, even though, you know, in a game mechanics sense, it probably doesn't help, right? And we're putting ourselves at a disadvantage.
You have to forego a lot of things you might otherwise use.
Right? Yeah, yeah. So what kind of options can we offer, Andre? I mean, I like the idea of, you know, having a follower who you could say, okay, this person is kind of training you or whatever.
Right. Let's see. What are some potential follower options?
Well, there are a lot of two-handed specialists. I mean, one thing a person could do, I suppose, is say that, you know, you were going to do the companions quest. You know,
yeah, there's several two-handed
the companions quest line.
All right, can I interrupt for a minute?
Yeah, go ahead.
Explain to me why one-handed, two-handed makes a difference in this case.
Well, in this case, this is a person who's played up,
primarily an archer
up to level 25, advancing archery and one-handed.
Yeah.
So they've acquired a lot of probably levels and buffs using one-handed weapons.
Gotcha.
Now they're going to face, you know, level 25 or 30 enemies with the equivalent of a level 1 sword skill.
Gotcha.
Right. So
that explains the reason why you were impressed at the changing of fighting style. I was just trying to get some context for why.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I like this, right? Because it's totally related to the conversation we just had about increasing the game challenge. Well, here you go. This is it right here. I mean, hell.
Switch up your weapon. Yeah,
exactly.
But with this weapon in particular, there's a cool thing with this weapon is that this weapon becomes more powerful over time, but the only way that this weapon becomes more powerful
is that you
have to kill in cold blood someone who trusts you.
Basically, you have to kill your followers.
Seriously?
Yeah. Every time you kill someone who trusts you, the weapon increases in power.
Right.
And so there is an opportunity here
what
for kind of an amazing role-playing thing here.
Yeah.
Particularly if you take on a follower, imagine this: you bring on a follower who is also, you know, maybe an older, more revered swordsman or swordswoman, right? Who is also a worshiper of Mephala, who is training you because they know that you're something special, and ultimately knows that in the end, when you complete your training, you will have to kill them, and that's how you will prove that you've made it. Right?
That you're worthy.
It's super dark, and it
really
adds
is.
Sort of a fatalistic quality to this whole thing where this devout follower says, you're the chosen one, and I'm going to train you
willing for this.
Until you kill me. When you kill me, then we know you're
so
ready.
It's the sacrifice on their part, and
don't mess it up and do it early.
That is awesome.
So that's
a great
probably
that's why I needed the context, because now I've got this whole new horizon of what that means.
Trying to think of, I don't know any off the top of my head. I know there's a lot of follower mods out there. I wonder if there would be one that would work well for this situation, or to pick a game, an already in-game NPC to do this with.
Yeah. I don't know.
That could fit the bill.
I think, obviously there's a lot of There's a lot of options probably. I think there are a lot of potential followers out there who use two-handed weapons, but I would be inclined to explore some of the options inside of interesting NPCs because there are some very sort of dark and troubled characters in there who I think could fit the bill personality-wise for this type of a scenario.
You know, if you don't have it already, in tangent or in tandem, rather, with interesting NPCs, you could use amazing follower tweaks. That way you can recruit anyone.
Right.
So if you come across a character that really grabs your attention, assuming they're not a quest character or something like that that's going to break something else, you can tweak them and bring them on as a follower that way.
Yep. I think there's probably a lot of options there. Amazing follower tweaks, you're right, would really open it up.
Yeah.
And then interesting NPCs add so many new characters to the game.
All over the
place. Yeah, you're bound to run into somebody sooner or later who, you know, kind of has a personality that resonates with you.
So there's your first part of your you know, internal quest is to go find a teacher.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yep, I think so.
Which could lead you down a whole lot of different rabbit holes.
It sure could. I know in interesting NPCs, I randomly encountered a character in the Winking Skeever. He was just sitting there drinking, and I walked up beside him to talk to the innkeeper, and he was super creepy. I can't remember. I can't remember his actual name. I want to say he was an orc.
Oh, was it the orc that challenges you?
Yeah. And he challenged me to say, okay, you know, we're going to see who can kill X number of people the fastest. And it was all based on
a name.
On Ulfric Stormcloak's name
and
the woman who's the Jarl in Solitude.
Right.
You had to find victims who, with the first letter.
And do them in order.
Was it in order?
I think you had to do them in order.
And then you had to finish, try to finish before he did.
Right.
There are a number of characters through that mod that are like that. And there's an entire website out there devoted to interesting NPCs. I'd go out there and just dig around a little bit, do a little bit of research on the characters that are there, read enough about their stories to figure out if they'd be a good character, first of all, and second of all, how to kick off their little side quests.
Their quest, if they have one.
Yeah, because then you could work that into your story. And
use that as your training schedule.
Yep.
So, and then you could use AFT.
Mm-hmm.
To haul them as a follower, and you can also use AFT to equip them. So if it's a character who's really fits what you're looking for, but maybe they don't have the big sword, give them one.
Yeah,
make it work.
Absolutely. The other alternative would just be to go out and look at other follower mods out there, and you know, pick one up that seems like a good fit. You know, I think of, for example, Volfar.
Yep.
Volfar is amazing. You know, he's a, you know, huge 8 foot tall barbarian kind of guy who uses a two handed weapon, and he's got a lot to say, and he's very colorful. That is definitely he's very much a zealot right? I think of a character like Hoth, extremely dark type of character. He wears a helmet that looks like a skull, and he's really.
I was just looking at that one the other day.
As an NPC, he's also unique in that when you go to certain places in Skyrim and you speak to him, he will tell you that there's someone nearby that needs killing. And he essentially gives you like these sort of mini radiant quests to either kill or apprehend, like, you know, bounties and stuff.
Interesting.
But it's all driven based on what part of Skyrim you're in at the time. So someone like Hoth could also be a great follower who kind of fits that dark image, but then also has the added bonus of pointing out targets.
While you're training.
Which sure sort can. Of feels yeah. interesting.
Which would work really well yeah. with an assassin-type character.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Now, Hoth is not a trainer in two-handed, and Valfar is not a trainer in two-handed.
Right.
So you just
have
to sort
role-play
of
role-play
play that, right?
Yeah.
But I think it's more important that the character fits the image of the story you're trying to tell.
Right. That's the feeling I get, too.
Yep. Yep. Absolutely.
So, a handful of great ideas to try.
Hopefully, hopefully that helps.
Yeah. All
Good
right.
Good question, Andre.
Absolutely. So what's next?
Let's see. Let me pull this up. We have a question from Idris. If I can get it to scroll. Okay. Oh, no, I'm good. And Idris from Wales writes, I recently made a Khajiit Dark Brotherhood assassin who only fights with his fists. I know you've done a podcast based around backstory, but I'm really struggling with it. Please help me out. Any advice is much appreciated.
Awesome.
There's a caveat here that this is a console player.
Console player. Wow.
So
modless.
Correct.
Yes.
So
okay.
that
I might actually be able to weigh in on something here.
That definitely makes it a little
time.
More difficult. So I can appreciate the conundrum.
Well,
I like the idea that going weaponless gives you a particular level of confidence to mm-hmm. go in. You know, your approach to different bad guys is going to be quite different because you have to. It's a very intimate kill, right?
It is. Bare hands. Well, what is it that Idris is struggling with? Is it backstory here, or what is it specifically
well,
on it?
Well, he mentions backstory. I almost get the feeling that there's just kind of this general loss or at a loss of kind of how to pull it all together.
Okay.
Sure. I don't know what the base mechanics are or what the vanilla game mechanics are for Khajiit and using claws.
Well,
I think there's mods out there, but again, that's not an option in this case.
The vanilla game provides some options.
It does. Okay. Cause having never played a Khajiit, I don't know.
Yeah. Khajiits do more hand-to-hand combat damage because of claws, but in the game, you also get additional damage by adding gauntlets. And so the higher level gauntlets you're adding, the more damage you get with your fists as well. Yep. So if you're using those wicked, nasty Daedric gauntlets and then fighting hand-to-hand, you're doing some really nasty damage that I think, can't be certain, but I think that would stack with the extra damage that you're getting as a Khajiit.
Okay.
Now, of course, the other thing that would be essential is get down in the rat way and kill that guy down there who's got the gloves of the pugilist.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Then disenchant those gloves, and then that's going to give you hand-to-hand combat damage, which you can also enchant your gauntlets with. And you may be able to enchant other items. I don't know. Like, if you could have an enchanted necklace or a ring combined with your gauntlets.
Seems like you might be able to, but I'm not certain.
Well, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of enchantments that are
I think
four
we
item
have someone who's willing to maybe try it out.
Yeah, there you go.
You know? So.
Where do you find this person, the pugilist?
You got to go to Riften and go down into the Ratway.
You'll run into him before you get to the Ragged Flagon.
Yeah, to get to the Ragged Flagon, you'll
basically
encounter
have to get through him.
Okay. But he's kind of an unassuming beggar-looking guy, but he's living down under the Ratway, and he will attack you with his bare hands, and he has the gloves of the pugilist. It's the only instance of that enchantment in the game. But that...
I think I may have those.
Yeah, that helps to make it a legit... kind of a play style. It is intended as a legitimate play style in Skyrim because there are kill cams for barehanded combat and all that stuff, which are really interesting, by the way. You know, doing some crazies, like sometimes wrestling moves and stuff like that.
Very
it's
cool.
really amazing. So
you don't have to be encumbered by a lot of heavy weapons.
Well, that's very,
very true.
That's a very good.
And you don't have to make a choice as to which weapons you're going to keep. Everything that you manage to get
hopefully
off
you
of
keep
your dead,
all the weapons that you went into combat with.
If not, then you're in trouble. No, but there's an advantage, a big moneymaker there, right? I mean, you can slay everybody and you don't have to worry about retaining any of the weapons.
Yes.
So you just go and sell them to the highest bidder, take your gold, do whatever you're going to do. So
mechanically, we've taken care of this, right? Now the question is, what are some things we can do from the role play mm-hmm. perspective that are part of this? And I think what you need to consider, Idris, is at the very core of this whole thing is why has this person chosen to kill with their bare hands? And what's the significance of that? Because mm-hmm. to me, that is so unusual that it's hard not to imagine that in just driving the whole psychology of this character.
Right.
That's what it seems like to me.
No, I agree.
Mm-hmm. I look at huge advantage in having some of the weapons, but it's a very personal thing.
Yeah.
To kill somebody with your bare hands.
Yes. Oh, and that could be part of it.
Yeah. So part of it could be ritualistic, right? Where mm-hmm. this is an individual who has so much heavy emotion around the taking of a human life that it feels disrespectful to have any distance from the process if you're really going to own it and say that I need to own this, right? I'm taking this person's life.
It has to literally be on my hands.
Yeah, it has to be. The blood has to be on my hands, and I have to take responsibility for what I'm doing, even though what I feel like I'm doing is the right thing right now. Or it could be someone who's just got some kind of an issue going on where you know, they're a rage monster, and maybe they've never had any formal training in melee combat, but they have become very good at just using their bare hands, you know?
Right.
And that's become their signature.
Yeah.
You know?
They've found they don't need weapons.
Yeah. Yeah. Maybe there's some kind of a really sort of visceral thing that comes from some past experience where, you know, they killed somebody with their bare hands who took the life of a loved one, and now they're this rage monster who...
And that's where I think if you look at the question about backstory, I mean, mm-hmm. there's all kinds of, you know, crossed lovers and, you know, the reason you're an orphan, you know why you're an orphan. I mean, things like that, you can look at those as backstory pieces as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. Yeah, so that I think there's a story to tell there.
It really revolves, not maybe it doesn't revolve, but a big piece of it is, you know, why they've chosen not to use any kind of weaponry.
Yeah, I mean, this is a significant choice, especially, depending on the road that this person decides to go down.
Right.
If we're talking about a character who wants to be an assassin.
You're looking at backstabs basically for everything.
And we're talking about someone who's getting right up against their opponent in light armor. Mm-hmm. Which more than likely, with maybe the exception of the gauntlets.
Yeah.
You know, that's dicey, right? That's someone who not only maybe is good at fighting with their hands, but that's someone who strikes me also as being fearless, like really fearless.
Almost insane.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
But you would have to be, right? I mean, you would have to find, there would have to be very good, potentially unfounded reasons for you to have that level of confidence and some amazing level of sneak and
So I would start by don't think about the background so much. Start by thinking about what makes this character fight with their bare hands. What are the vulnerabilities of this character? Start with the vulnerabilities and say, you know, what is it about this individual that makes this particular style of combat essential for them? Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of stuff will just kind of flow from there. It's such a strong idea that that there are going to be all kinds of really strong things that will come out of it, I think.
And you can also get creative with maybe some of the magic use.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely.
Bring that into
just
it.
Because you aren't using a bladed weapon or anything doesn't mean that you can't do other things
with it to augment your attacks.
Yeah.
For sure.
Right. Add some magical, you know, armor enhancement, right? You know, so defensive
one.
There. You could use some of the if you're going to build a mythos around this whole thing, then I would do things like maybe avoid spells, avoid range weapons, avoid range spells. If you're going to use a spell, use something like flame cloak.
That's personal.
You know, that surrounds you in a roiling mass of flame, and then you attack
That's
with your bare
spell.
Hands. I mean, to me, what that feels like is it doesn't feel, those things together don't feel like a spell. It feels like almost like a power a person would have.
Right.
I'm this burning pillar of rage, and I burst into flame.
Exactly.
Yeah, I burst into flame, and then I attack with my bare hands because I'm just savage, right?
Yeah.
There's something kind of cool about that, you know, making it feel like it's an innate part of the person rather than a spell.
Mm-hmm. So choose the spells and abilities, and if you go get the Dragonborn going, you've got shouts.
Think about the shouts, yeah. And the elemental speed shout, the slow.
Oh, whirlwind, yeah, whirlwind sprint.
Well, there's whirlwind sprint, but then there's an elemental combat spell or shout. And when you shout, you're basically able, as long as you're not using an enchanted weapon, you can attack at like double the attack speed.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I think I know what you mean.
Right? And then there's also slow time.
Yeah, that's another great one.
Which, you know, pick the shouts and the spells from the vanilla game that really fit the combat style, which is up close and personal, visceral, kind of no range weapons. That's what I'd do.
Yeah.
It's really strong. Yeah, I like it.
Yeah, be no pretty kidding. Vicious, actually.
Really. I think that combination.
Slow down time and
spells
get
and
some
enchantments.
Good gauntlets and...
Yeah.
Fire up and
absolutely
tear into your opponent.
Exactly right.
Yeah,
Draugr is going to be tough.
Mm-hmm.
And it also too, maybe it depends on: are you hand to hand all the time, or just when you're assassinating?
Oh, that could be too. It could be too. Although with a character like this, it's hard to imagine them making exceptions, but maybe they would.
Yeah, I guess depending on the kind of the mental state that you want to try to play.
What kinds of things might you forego in the quests if you were just doing assassination type quest following? What kinds of things might you not be able to do if you're not?
Well, I don't think there's anything that you could not do. I think there are things that would become, you'd have to be more creative and would be more difficult.
Yeah. You know, one thing that strikes me too is that a good thing for this character to pursue would also be, I love the idea of this character doing the Boethia side quest for a couple of different reasons. One is that when you go to the Shrine of Boethia, there's all those people fighting. It's got very much a pit fighter type of a feel to it. And those cultists are all about combat, and they're very savage in the way that they do it.
They're tough.
And they can be very tough. The other thing too is that, you know, the magic item that you get after completing that quest would be particularly interesting for this character. I forget what it's called. Do you remember?
I'm drawing a blank.
It's Boethia's mail.
Ebony armor.
Is that what it is?
Is that what it is?
Well,
is it the ebony mail?
Not, yeah, it's ebony mail, but it classifies as light armor.
Does it?
It's not. It looks like it's called ebony mail, and it shares some characteristics with ebony armor.
It looks like the ebony armor.
But it's actually considered light.
Yeah.
What I like about it is it basically surrounds your character in an aura of darkness, which is poison. And it would be sort of...
it pisses everyone off.
It would be like...
around you.
It would be the equivalent of sort of... poisoning your fists and attacking somebody, right?
Sweet.
I mean, that would be very cool. One thought I had was, would a character like this have any interest at all in investing in alchemy for the reasons of creating poisons, but you can't poison your gauntlets in the vanilla game.
Right.
However, this would be a way to sort of simulate that, where it's a personal area of effect. You know, and anybody who's fighting you in close proximity is going to be poisoned as you're fighting them.
Yeah.
It's perfect for the character who's either going to come up and punch you or bear hug you and poison you to death, right?
Right.
So I think that would be a great.
That's a good.
And there's no detriment to you as the player with that?
No. And the cool thing about it, though, is, you know, it surrounds you in this black swirling aura of nastiness, which is, I think, pretty cool.
Looks awesome.
I've never really worn the stuff just because it has some unintended effects just of that.
Yeah.
It's kind of like on all the time. So
when you go into stealth mode.
Does it affect your followers?
Oh, is it just stealth mode?
Just stealth mode.
Oh, that's not
bad. Does it affect your followers?
I think it affects anyone that's nearby. I don't know if it's...
Yeah.
Some things can be just enemies, but I'm not positive, but this might just be anyone.
I don't know what the radius is, but I want to say that it affects other people. The reason I kind of stayed away from it is that this kind of black swirling aura effect screwed with my ability to fire the bow. It would obstruct my vision.
Oh.
Even in first person, it would obstruct my vision, so I couldn't see my opponents.
But for this person, wouldn't matter.
No, that wouldn't be a problem. Yeah.
And to know if you could combine that with the gauntlets and everything else.
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden you become...
personal effect spell. Mm-hmm. And
yeah.
Mm-hmm. You become someone that no one wants to get near.
Yeah. So,
which might make the emotional burden of why you went into hand-to-hand killing in the first place even worse.
Well, do it.
I only did it to be close to people.
Do it, Idris, and tell us how it turns out. It sounds really cool.
Yeah, it does.
I think you got plenty of options technically in vanilla, as well as a whole bunch of kind of cool spell and shout things that you could do. I would just come up with that vulnerability, that story, and then pick the stuff that fits.
Perfect.
So,
great. Thank you for the question.
Thank you.
Absolutely. And that is it for episode 13, which kind of turned out to be pretty darn epic. I liked this one a lot.
I agree.
So, you know, thank you so much. We've made it to the end of yet another episode. We'd like to thank fans of the show for your faithful support and continued encouragement. Your enthusiasm is the lifeblood of this podcast, and whether your support comes through Patreon with dollars or through iTunes with reviews or recommendations to your friends and family, we appreciate it all. Yes. You can contact us through the website at charactercrusade.com. And until next time, remember, it is not about the objective. It's about the journey. So go forth and experience.
Bow. Bow. Bow, now, now, now. Bow.
I love that song.
Bow, now, now, now.
You know what that song, the title of that song is? It's called Busy.
Is it really?
It's called Busy.
Getting busy.
Candlehearth Hall, and I played there, and then they in Candlehearth Hall there's a group of three people that play together there, and I think that's because of interesting NPCs. I think in the vanilla game there's only one bard there, but because of interesting NPCs there are three people that play together. And the funny thing is they're using the vanilla songs, but they set up the timing so that they have a drum part and a flute part and a singing part.
Seriously?
That go together.
Oh, cool.
And it sounds fucking terrible. It sounds terrible.
I thought you were going to say it sounded fantastic.
No, it was awful. It was awful. And so I'm playing through this in my mind. He's playing this song, like the dexterity required to play it is amazing, right? And all this stuff. And he finishes, and then they start, and it's like, whoa, you know? And he's like, what? You know, that's when he did the whole, you know,
down.
Like, You know, that's, you know, that sounds like somebody strangling a fucking cat. You know, I think I'm going to go to the gray quarter. So he went to the corner club to play there.
Funny.
And he walks in and there's like one bartender and a guy sweeping the floor. And I'm like, you know, and it's like crickets.
That's
because
everyone else is down listening to the melee song.
I know. And so I was like, all right, fellas, fine. You know, let's do this. And so I just found a position like kind of next to the wall and I started playing. And once you're in that mode where you're playing the song, you can't really break out of it. The animation has to go until it's done or whatever. And so the guy is sweeping the floor or whatever. And the bartender's like, he turns and he's facing me and he's playing away. Right. And the guy with the broom then walks over like really uncomfortably close and then walks behind him and is hanging out behind him while he's playing. And because of the player head tracking, Robard's like, like this. And what I realized was that that's where the character is scripted to go.
Yeah.
He's going to sweep in the corner, and then he's going to sweep by the door, and then he's going to sweep in the corner. And it got to a point.
You're in my space.
Where he's like halfway through the song. He's halfway through the song, and the guy's broom handle's like getting like really close to Robard's ass and stuff. And I'm thinking in my head, like, this is so, I could so role play Robard in this moment, right? And the guy stops sweeping, and then he starts eating a piece of bread behind me, like really close, like behind me. And the whole time I'm thinking, okay, thank you very much, you know. And on the sourdough is what the fuck, you know, like that's what I'm thinking to myself. And so that
you have one old message. Thursday, 2:09 p.m.
You know, so I like started to create this character in the game and like I'm not really sure what I was supposed to pick because I wanted my guy to be kind of like, you know, a 1920s sort of gangster sort of guy. But that doesn't really work with what I'm trying to do here in the Skyrim. And so I gave this guy a really cool name. You know, his name is Jimmy. Because nobody else in Skyrim would have the name Jimmy. So he's got the name Jimmy, and he's awesome, right? He's this guy, and he's got a mace. But nobody else has got a mace around here. It's kind of like a big warhammer sort of a thing, but it's even cooler than that because it's like a big lead sort of crown kind of thing that you just, like, swing and beat the crap out of people. That's the kind of thing that Jimmy likes to do. You know, he likes to find stuff, but I kind of think that maybe his family had it out for him when he was a kid. So Jimmy's all about bringing it back. It's about bringing it back to the Skyrim people and reminding everybody who he is. You know, that's sort of the start of my story. So go look for Jimmy. Jimmy might just kick your ass, but he's also this great guy. You know, he's kind of a family guy. Well, like a family wrecking guy, actually, now that I think about it. So he's not like a family guy. Especially not like a family guy like the TV show, The Family Guy. No, that guy's kind of a wuss. Anyway, let me figure this out. Maybe I'll call it another time. Awesome job, Character Crusade. The podcasts are awesome. Keep it up.
End of messages.